I have no interest in being public in the United States right now. None. Okay. Well, you know, I'm not really popular at the SEC. Gary Gensler is a big fan of mine.
You're a headache.
I'm a headache, for sure. I'm going to keep being a headache. I mean, by the way, that's really important. Like, I think we need people who are going to speak truth to power when the power is not following even the law.
안녕하세요. 키웨스트 투자인 사이트 김 PD입니다. 24년 9월 3일부터 4일까지 키웨스트는 서울 그랜드 워커힐 호텔에서 열린 코리아 블록체인 위크 중 컨퍼런스 행사인 임팩트에 참석하였습니다. 키웨스트는 업무 집중을 위해 행사 하루 전날부터 그랜드 워커힐 서울에서 2박 3일 동안 숙박하며 이번 행사에 참석하였습니다. 리프레시 CEO 브래드 갈링하우스는 KBW 2024 임팩트 2일차 행사에서 데클린 멜리네크와의 대담을 진행했습니다. 키웨스트는 브래드 갈링하우스를 만나 키웨스트를 소개하고 리플 본사 방문에 대한 이야기를 나누는 특별한 기회를 가졌습니다. 갈링하우스는 사진 요청에도 기꺼이 응해주어 소중한 순간을 함께할 수 있었습니다. 키웨스트는 22년 미국 텍사스주 오스틴 행사에서 갈링하우스를 본 적이 있었으나 이와 같은 기회를 얻기는 매우 어려웠습니다. 다행히 키웨스트가 우측 1열 맨 앞에 착석하고 있었기 때문에 행운 같은 소중한 만남이 이루어질 수 있었습니다. 갈링하우스의 연설 중에는 리플 로고가 새겨진 귀여운 양말도 발견할 수 있었습니다. 브래드 갈링하우스는 미국 달러 담보 스테이블 코인인 리플 USD의 공식 출시가 몇 주 내로 이루어질 것이라고 말했습니다. 또한 그는 미국 증권거래위원회에 대한 비판적인 입장을 드러내며 미국에서 기업 공개를 하지 않을 것이라고 강조했습니다. 브래드 갈링하우스의 발언은 리플의 비전과 함께 현재의 암호화폐 환경에 대한 깊은 통찰을 제공하며 앞으로의 방향성을 제시하고 있기 때문에 많은 관심과 주의가 필요합니다. 그럼 KBW 2024 9월 4일 임팩트 2일차 행사 리플 CEO 브래드 갈링하우스의 인터뷰 영상을 함께 살펴보겠습니다.
I am Jacqueline Melanick. I am the co-founder of Token Relations, and I am joined with the CEO of Ripple, Brad Garlinghouse. As many of you know, Ripple had an ongoing case with the SEC that lasted 3, maybe 4 years,
Almost depending on who you ask.
Yeah. And essentially, they were in and out of the headlines from December 2020 to now,
right.
Always in the headlines. And essentially, Ripple scored a win against the SEC, and it determined that XRP is not a security, which is huge.
I think it's not just important for Ripple, it's not just important for the XRP community, it's also important for, as we were introduced, the crypto industry at large. Yeah, I mean, the good news is there's a lot of countries around the world that have leaned into providing clear rules of the road for crypto. The United States is not an example of that, unfortunately. And the U.S. is the largest economy, but it was super important, I think, to set the precedent for the crypto industry at large that just because it's a token does not mean it's a security, which was kind of the approach the U.S. SEC was taking. So we feel really good about it, and I think there's going to be more wins. Kraken just scored a win in the United States a week or two ago, and I think we'll eventually get to a better place.
There's a lot of different ones out there that, honestly, I'm a former reporter, and I became almost a legal reporter covering all of this. And when the OpenSea one happened, I kind of like rolled my eyes because it just feels like it's one after another. So how are you viewing it as someone who like went through the ringer and now you're on the outside?
You know, when Gary Gensler took over the SEC, 3 years ago or so, one of the first things he did is he asked for more budget to hire more enforcement lawyers. Now you think about that. Okay, so instead of taking the time to write laws and to codify, here's how regulation should work for crypto, he took the approach of, we're gonna go sue some more people. And look, that's not a good way to create sound regulation and sound policy. And sure enough, those lawsuits have actually added confusion to the system. And there's sometimes the SEC has taken the position that something's a security, there's sometimes they've taken a position that it's not. And you've had judges really go after them. In some of the ETF ruling, the judge wrote, this is a quote, said that the SEC was being arbitrary and capricious. Now, you know, this is pretty insulting to an organization that is supposed to work for the people. Like, we forget, like, these are government organizations that are supposed to work for the people. And I think many of them lost sight of that as, I think the SEC kind of lost sight of that. So the case against OpenSea, look, you know, they're taking the position that NFTs are securities. You know, there's already been case law about how art, meaning traditional art, is not. And that just because someone might speculate on the price of a piece of art, that it might go up, that doesn't make it a security. And so, look, I think they have a losing case, and I think it's really unfortunate for OpenSea because, look, Ripple spent over $150 million defending ourselves. Not every company can do that. And so I don't know OpenSea well. I respect the leadership there, and I hope they're in a position where they can fight this fight because, you know, the SEC is bullying people, and I think it does set, you know, a dangerous precedent for other governments around the world. And so I always try to highlight countries like the United Kingdom, countries like Japan, countries like Singapore, countries like Switzerland that really have invested the time and energy to provide clear rules of the road. Because I think, as you and I both have experienced, most people in crypto want to follow the rules of the road. We just need to know where the rules are. When the decision came out, when Ripple won the case and they declared that XRP is not a security, I definitely took some time and with some friends to celebrate a bit with my kids. So I think you do have to kind of step back and appreciate some of the wins along the way. And I think it applies to all entrepreneurship, and building companies in the crypto space is hard. And there's a lot of obstacles. And I think you do have to every once in a while appreciate and take stock of the good things along the way. It's a good question. I mean, as Jacqueline was describing, about 95% of Ripple's customers, and these are banks, financial institutions, payment providers, even on the custody side of our business, it expands a little bit beyond that. But about 95% of our customers are outside the United States. And part of that is because when you have a lawsuit from a regulator like the SEC, it freezes the market and people are like, whoa, I'm not going to touch this. Now, after we've won the case, one would think that might unlock the market. The reality is the U.S. government remains pretty hostile towards crypto in general. And, you know, the SEC approved Coinbase going public in the United States, and now the SEC is suing Coinbase for the same things they approved in their what's called an S-1 in the United States. So, I have no interest in being public in the United States right now. None. Eventually, maybe we'll cross that bridge, but for now, you know, I'm not really popular at the SEC. Gary Gensler is a big fan of mine.
You're a headache.
I'm a headache, for sure. I'm going to keep being a headache. I mean, it's not that
but
I try
to...
But
it benefited the industry in the end.
By the way, that's really important. Like, I think we need people who are going to speak truth to power when the power is not following even the law. I mean, Gary Gensler goes out and talks about he used an expression called a digital asset security. That is not a legal term. That doesn't exist.
But he made it one. No.
Well, I'll also tell you, you know, maybe more news to come on this, but Gary Gensler also has gone out to say, this is a quote, the leading lights of crypto in the United States are either in jail, going to jail, or being extradited to go to jail. Okay, now, is this an objective view of an industry, or is this a guy who has just decided every actor in this space is a bad actor? It's called defamation.
Yeah, that's not good. And that means everyone in this room is screwed. Which is
well,
not the case.
I will say, one of the first, you and I obviously both hail from the United States, but one of the first pieces of advice I give entrepreneurs who ask me about starting crypto companies is don't incorporate in the United States. You're just asking for more legal bills. Incorporate in a jurisdiction that has clear rules of the road. Singapore is great. Switzerland is great. The UK is great. Japan is great. There's a lot of good answers. It just happens to be the United States is not one of them.
Yeah.
Certainly grown quickly. It has some of the largest banks in the world. HSBC is an example of a customer there. And then, as you mentioned, we're in the process of launching a new stablecoin. And look, I think the stablecoin market is exciting and obviously has grown. We're at about $170 billion market today. some have forecasted it to be $2 trillion in 5 years. You know, Ripple already was using stablecoins in our payment flows with our customers. And there was a time when we were that Ripple was minting 20% of all USDC. And so we felt like, look, it only makes sense. Obviously, there was a big event last spring in the United States, I mean, a year, 18 months ago, where USDC depegged. And we felt like there was an opportunity for a credible player that's already working with lots of financial institutions. It's because we're in the payments business from our origins.
Regionally speaking, we talked a lot about the US. We are in Korea right now. Where are you seeing the most demand right now, maybe in the Asian market? What are the trends that you're following here and talking about while you're in town?
Well, I mean, part of the reason I'm here is because Asia Pacific and specifically Korea has been such a leader, and the enthusiasm around these technologies has been so high. So we've had a vibrant business in the region. We announced a couple things. One, we are working with a number of local universities, most recently Yonsei, where we are actually sponsoring research and education around crypto and blockchain. And again, not just about XRP, but about crypto broadly. My experience has been if crypto does well, Ripple's going to do well also. And so we want to see all boats rise with that tide.
구독자 여러분들을 위해 보다 안정적이고 전략적인 투자로 나아가게 해줄 키웨스트 투자 인사이트 네이버 프리미엄 콘텐츠를 소개하려고 합니다. 24년 8월 9일 키웨스트 투자 인사이트는 주식 투자자들에게 키웨스트가 직접 만들고 분석한 자료를 독점 제공하기 위하여 재테크 카테고리 내 유료 콘텐츠 서비스를 시작하게 되었습니다. 키웨스트 투자 인사이트 채널을 통해 키웨스트는 실시간 시장 동향, 깊이 있는 분석, 그리고 투자 전문가의 비법을 담은 독점 콘텐츠를 제공합니다. 실무 경험과 국내외 기업체 방문을 바탕으로 차별화된 정보를 주 5회 이상 업로드합니다. 지금 바로 네이버 프리미엄 콘텐츠 키웨스트 투자 인사이트 채널을 구독하시고 키웨스트만의 탁월한 분석을 매일 살펴보세요. 여러분의 성공적인 투자 파트너 키웨스트 투자 인사이트가 함께합니다. 앞으로도 퀘스트의 유익한 영상을 보고 싶으시다면 퀘스트 구독 꾹 눌러주시고 알림 설정 해주시기 바랍니다. 퀘스트 유튜브 서포터스에 가입하시면 퀘스트 채널의 서포터스 회원 전용 영상을 시청하실 수 있습니다. 심지윤 디지털 경제협의회 사무국장은 대한민국의 경제 발전을 위해서 KBS, YTN 등 뉴스 출연을 통한 공익적 자문활동, 국회 입법 지원, 칼럼 기고, 블록체인 등 경제 강의, 투자 관련 유튜브 콘텐츠 제작, 유튜브 비투슈와 박작가 크립토 연구소, 정법전 TV, 블록체인 타임즈, 코인 투자 학교, 웅달 책방 출연 등 다방면의 활동을 하고 있습니다. 또한 디지털 블록체인 투자 관련 도서 키웨스트 디지털 자산 투자를 출간했으며 투자 과정에서 직접 겪은 경험과 노하우를 살려 개미를 대표하는 일에 앞장서고 계십니다. 아울러 키웨스트 77의 대표로서 투자 분석, 교육, 컨설팅 및 투자 활동을 하고 있습니다. 키웨스트는 아모레퍼시픽 사내 장학생으로 성균관 글로벌 MBA를 2012년 수료하였으며 식스시그마 마스터 블랙벨트 자격을 1위의 성적으로 취득하였고 사내 공식 컨설턴트로서 부문별 임원진의 혁신 활동을 지원하였습니다. 또한 교육을 통한 인재 육성에도 각별한 애정을 갖고 있어 교육기관, 자선단체 등 다양한 곳에 기부도 지속하고 있습니다. 혼란스럽고 어려운 암호화폐 주식시장에서 나홀로 투자하는 것에 어려움을 겪고 계시다면 전 세계를 직접 누비며 해외 기업을 조사하고 저명한 컨퍼런스 등에 직접 참여하는 검증된 투자 분석 전문가 키웨스트에게 도움을 요청하셔서 성공으로 가는 투자 방법을 배우시고 경제적 자유를 누리시는 길에 한 걸음 더 다가가시길 기원합니다.